Thank you. aren't perfect. You are very real.
All right.
But.
Ringer is the one who's in us. Greater is the one who calls our name. He will never fail. And stronger is the one within us. Stronger. It's your breath. In all.
same yesterday, today, and forever. It's the same Jesus that's standing before us today, that's resident in your life today. It's the same Jesus. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. This is Jesus, not just a good teacher, not just an incredible prophet, not just did amazing things, but Jesus, the Bible says, was the exact representation of God. In Hebrews chapter 1 and Colossians chapter 1, remember that? The exact image of God on the earth, right? He's the image of the invisible God. That's who came to earth. The Bible says that he came to earth because God so loved us, he sent his son, the very exact representation of him, to the earth. Because of his love for mankind, for me and for you. That's why Jesus came. Not just a good man, not just an incredible miracle worker, not just a great prophet, but the Son of God, God himself, here on the earth. Remember that when we're talking, talking through this? You know how they do exit polls after a primary election or after an election, you know, they'll do exit polls, right? And, you know, so what was it that brought you out today? You know, what is the most important issue for you? You know, they'll ask these questions to kind of poll the audience, just to kind of get, you know, like, what is it that motivated you to be here? And then they can categorize all those results and so forth. I just feel that in church, there should be like an exit poll that we know who it is that we have met. And we know why we just went ahead and gave him our heart, gave him our week again, and gave him all our sorrows and all our weaknesses. Why we did what we did. Because his message is powerful and it resonates with us. And his invitation, he keeps coming after us. Isn't that right with his invitation? I just feel that we should know. We should know. And so that's what we're talking about this week. You know, making it really easy for you to say, you know what? You know what I find in church? You know what I've found since I've started following Jesus? So that you know to say that and to speak that when you're handing out all those Easter flyers. Praise God. Jesus has a stump speech too. And you know, as he speaks it, as he invites us into these things, I don't know about you, but he gets my heart. He gets my vote. He gets my allegiance. Amen. Praise God. Here's an invitation of Jesus. John chapter 7. Thank you, Spirit of God. You come and reveal Jesus to us right now, living color. Thank you for it. John chapter 7, verse 37. On the last day, that great day of the feast. I'm going to just pause there. This is John 7, verse 37. Google it up. Flip there if you have a paper Bible. It's right on page 941. That might not help you at all. On the last day, that great day of the feast. Well, we know here, if you kind of study some of the context and so forth, that this feast was the Feast of Tabernacles. I don't know if you know anything about Jewish culture, you know, but they would have this, they still do. You know, the Feast of Tabernacles was a 7 or 8 day, you know, historians and theologians are kind of like a little bit divided about this, but and basically a week-long celebration that commemorated the 40 years that God took care of the Israelites as they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, all right? So basically a week-long party, a week-long celebration that commemorated those 40 years that the Israelites spent in the wilderness. You know, which is quite something. You know, they would have several of these feasts throughout the year that would cause the Jewish people, the Israelites, to remember what God had done for them. And of course, in the wilderness, there was one point where the Israelites were complaining, and then, you know, like it looked like they were going to die of thirst and from lack of water. You know, and there's one point where Moses, he struck the rock, and like just as a rock in the wilderness, he struck the rock and water. Can you imagine? Like the heat beating down and the, you know, like, and the, we need water. You know, you imagine the families and the desperation and the, what have you brought us out here for? You know, it would be better for us, you know. And Moses, he struck the rock and water poured out. This is a picture of what Jesus does for us. Anyway, so they would commemorate this and how in the wilderness for 40 years there was faithfully, there was food, right? Manna, the Bible calls, on the ground for them to eat. The Bible says that their shoes didn't wear out. You know, it talks about divine health during those 40 years. And And after that was over, after the Israelites went into the promised land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and all the irrigation was already there, you know, 40 years in the wilderness, and they went in and they conquered the promised land. You can find it in Exodus 23 and Leviticus 23. You can find out where it was specified that they should take a whole week and they should remember what it is that God had done for their forefathers generations ago for 40 years in the wilderness. And so this was the Feast of Tabernacles. They were instructed to actually go outside their homes and build like little huts, like a minimum of three walls, you know, the little tents, yeah? Anybody into camping? I mean, you know, this is the biblical reference for camping. Yeah, come on, kids, you know. I don't know. It's a bit of a stretch, perhaps, but you go out there and, you know, you find a plot of land and you build a tent, you build a hut, because this is how they lived for 40 years, and they didn't have to take it all in. You know, as time went on, you know, living in a hut for a week turned into, let's just have a meal in a hut, you know. It sounds like human nature, isn't it? You know what, let's just pick a meal a week and let's have it in the hut, you know, because we have to remember what God did for us. And so different religious observances. On the last day of the feast, and they called it the great day, it was when every Israelite male, basically, they would all come, they would bring their families, and they all had to go to the temple in Jerusalem. And in the temple in Jerusalem, it was a solemn day, like a sober, not solemn like miserable, but solemn as in holy kind of a day. And they would all come to the temple and they would do these sacrifices, you know, in the temple. And in fact, the sacrifice in the temple would continue like every day for 7 days. And on the last day, some historians say they wouldn't sacrifice anything, or they would only sacrifice one bull. In fact, you know, I think it's 70 bulls they would sacrifice over the course of the Feast of Tabernacles. Like 70, you know, you imagine what that would have been like to commemorate or to show or to display or to pray and intercede for the 70 nations of the world is kind of. But on the last day, they would sacrifice one bull. And if, you know, as they sacrificed the bull, what would happen is they would bring water from the pool of Siloam. The priest would bring water, and there would be another priest waiting at the altar, whatever, and they would take the, you know, and there would be thousands of people in the temple courts, in the temple area, thousands of people, and the priest would come bring water, you know, because, you know, the way, the miraculous way the water was poured out was just incredible during the 40 years, and they wanted to commemorate that. They'd bring water. You know, as the decades wore on and the generations wore on, you know, this became a lot about God bless, pour water out on our forthcoming season, let there be lots of rain, you know, like it became, you know, praying for, you know, that sort of thing. But they were commemorating and they were praying and they were remembering, and they would bring the water, and then the one priest would pour out the water and the other priest would pour out the wine, and the throng of thousands of people would begin to chant and to speak out from Psalm 113 to Psalm 118. You can kind of check that out. And they would kind of like go through this and just kind of like speak it out or whatever. And when they poured out the water, there would be this great cheer. You know, this great, like, and they would have trumpets there. You can read about it. Leviticus 23. And so they had this trumpet, and it was like shouts of joy, which is where Nehemiah talks about, you know, that with joy you will draw water from the well of salvation. This is where Nehemiah is like what he's referring to. And there should be like shouts of joy, just this like crazy time in the temple, but like holy and set apart for God. You know how religious observances go, though. There would be like a lot of kind of rote in it. A lot of like, okay, here we go. We're going to go do this again. And here's what we're remembering. And you know, it was also foreshadowing about a time that Joel, the prophet Joel, talked about how in the last days God would pour out his spirit. You know, so it was prophetic. And they were speaking about a Messiah that would come. And all these ideas were in this Feast of Tabernacles. And right at the juncture where the priest poured out the water and the other priest mixed it with wine, and it would go over this one last final sacrifice, which was for God's people, for the nation of Israel, this is the moment that we're reading about. On the last day, that great day of the feast, here's what it says. Jesus stood up, or stood, and he cried out, saying... He stood. In other words, he would have been observing. You know, the essence there in the original language is that he was observing and he was standing apart on some sort of like platform or some sort of raised area that he stood. right? I mean, lots of people would have been standing, so it's not like Jesus was cross-legged on the floor and then he stood up. You know, so the essence is that he took himself apart from the crowd, and perhaps he was waiting there for a while, just watching all this religious observance. Can you imagine what would have been, what he would have been thinking? You know, this is all about him, the living water. And these are his people that he has come to sacrifice his life for and show the way of salvation. And here they all are going about whatever they're going about in the religious observance. And some people fanatical about it. And some people kind of like, here we are, we do this every year. You know, and the kid's playing and the dust in the air. And he's just kind of watching this whole thing. And he's watching the sacrifice and watching the priests go up. And he's watching the other priest waiting with the wine. And then he hears the great jubilation and the great crying out that someday the water's going to be poured out again for the thirst for our souls. And he watches this religious observance and the shouting and the chanting and the Psalm 113:18, which he wrote. And he's like watching it all kind of unfold before him. I'm going to ask him, but I think perhaps what's going on the inside of his heart, and I will ask him someday, is, I'm right here. Yeah. I'm right here. Yeah. People, can't you see? Your salvation is here. I'm right here. Historians say, so right after the water was poured out, there would be this pregnant pause in the celebration. All the crowd would die down. It would be this moment of almost silence where the noise would quiet down. And everybody would just be there like Selah. Like this is coming. This was done. This is coming. We don't know for a fact. But this is neat to think of it. That this is exactly where Jesus stood up and he cried out. I didn't say shouted or just kind of like something that came out of his mouth was like a cry. Like an impassioned plea. Like an invitation that extends across the centuries to you and me. And here's what he said. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink.
Yes.
Listen, folks, this is, he's not talking about, hey, would you like, you know, a bottle of water? Are you thirsty? It's been a long day and you've been shouting a lot. You know. Mixed in with the prophetic symbolism and the commemoration of what they're doing are all these ideas about who, what God did and what God wants to do. It's all spiritual. Like everything that they're doing is physical reality for a spiritual, physical action for a spiritual reality. And here's what Jesus said. If anyone thirsts, you know what that's like, right? The longing for significance. The thirst, I mean, you felt it, I felt it, it's in our society, for spiritual substance, for something that matters, for something that's going to fill the void that we were birthed into the world with, that nothing, no matter how hard we try, satisfies. And even as followers of Jesus, we try so many things in different ways to satisfy that longing, but it leaves us empty. That thirst, the thirst for spiritual water. Come on now, don't pretend you don't know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about, right? I mean, it's not very far from our memory or from us or from where we are today that there's a thirst that's not, it's like a literal thirst, but it's not a literal thirst. There's something deep within that calls out. Jesus addressed it when he said, if you have that thirst, if you are thirsty like that, like somebody that was walking around in the wilderness, if you are thirsty like that, for something to be poured out upon your life that's going to change everything for you in the way that you understand God, If you're thirsty, if you know what I mean by thirst, Jesus said. Because like our society, like the people that you rub shoulders with at work, maybe even at home, they don't know. Many don't know that they're thirsty. They're not in touch with that thirst. They would say, what are you talking about? Let's go out for a beer. Sure, I'm thirsty. They wouldn't know necessarily what you're talking about. Isn't that right? So he says, those of you that know, those of you that when I say this, it resonates with something on the inside. If you're thirsty, Jesus said, let him come to me and drink. It's like Jesus is saying, people that have come to save, my own people, I'm right here. I'm right here. Yeah. All this shouting and all this stuff and all this religious observance. All these religious things that you do, you see? They're not going to satisfy. They're a form and a way to and provide the platform of understanding, but they can't satisfy. Jesus is saying, I'm the only one that can satisfy you. It's not about a religious routine or an observance. It's not about a feast that you hold every year. It's not about fulfilling the letter of the law. None of that will satisfy you. Jesus is saying, everything that you're doing, I'm right here. Can you see what was going through his mind? I don't know where you go with this, but I play with this in my own mind to think of my own religious observance. You know, the way that I'll pray for me, or the way that I'll, you know, come in on a Sunday morning and we'll sing those songs and we'll clap and we'll stand and we'll sit, you know, all at the right times, you know, and we'll kind of do our thing. Are you aware, like I'm aware, that you can go through all that and Jesus can be standing right beside you saying, psst, I'm right here. That it's a religious thing, that he's standing off in the corner somewhere. Guys, I'm right here. I just feel that this invitation is for Jesus to pull the wraps off of our religion. The wraps off of our religiosity. Are you with me? Yeah. Of our just kind of familiarity with church and the way that I do my devotions and the way that I talk to Jesus in the car. He's just going to pull that familiarity off and he's going to show himself in living color. And there's never going to be another boring moment in church or in my life because Jesus is right there. He's standing right there. And he said, if I'm thirsty, I can just come to him and take a drink. This is what the Bible, this is what Jesus talks about when he says, come to me and drink. The coming to God. You know this, maybe you're familiar with this or thinking about this. This is how it works. To come to God requires faith. This is how we come. We say, Jesus, I believe in what you, in who you say you are. Jesus, I believe in what you offer and I bring my heart to you. That's what it means to come to Jesus. You do it by faith. You don't do it necessarily by an understanding, like I've got all this figured out, I know exactly how it works. Dear God, when's the last time that happened about anything? Isn't that right? There's an air of mystery around this, but you approach God and you say, God, I don't understand all this, but God, I present to you my heart. I come before you right now. Listen, just in the same way that someone in that crowd on the last day, on the great day of the feast, when Jesus stood up. In the same way that someone sitting down in the crowd or standing around, there's that man that did all that healing. There's that man I talked to. I heard him talk to the Father. He talked to God like he was his dad. There's something on his life that's completely different. And he talked about a completely different way of life. I think I want what he has. And so when he stood up to say, if anybody thirsts, let him come to me. That person in their own heart, in their heart would have been like, I want to. Here I come, God. Isn't that right? In the same way, because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, forever, you and me, in our lives, no matter where we're at in our relationship with God, no matter how much we think we understand him or not, can have an acquaintance with God that surpasses what we've had before, simply because in our hearts we're like, God, I want to come to you and I want to receive what you have. That's good preaching. Why, thank you very much.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
You thirsty this morning? Every desire of the soul of mankind, every longing for spiritual meaning, significance, and power, every longing of your heart to be loved, to be noticed, to know that you can do what is in front of you to do, every longing of your heart. Church, we don't need all the things that we think we need. We just need more of Jesus. We need to be more Jesus saturated. Not more social media saturated. Not more outing with friends saturated. Isn't that right? Come on now. Not more media, not more TV, not more movies saturated. You know, I don't know. Whatever it is that you think you need, money, advancement in your work, no matter what it is you think you need, we don't need what we think we need. We need more of Jesus. And unlike all the other needs that we might think we need, it's Jesus that we need. Jesus is the real deal. I present to you that we can have church, that you can have church, that you can have a life with God where Jesus presents himself in full and real living color, that he's the real deal, that it's not the religious routine and observance, but it's with Jesus. I want to tell you this morning, that everything that you need, it's provided for in Jesus. Everything that you need is provided for in Jesus. In 2 Peter chapter 1, the Bible says this, that God's power has given you and me, he says, it's everything that we need for life and for godliness. That the promise of Jesus, the invitation of Jesus, in it is everything that we need. I want to say this, that it has been provided. It is ours. The Bible says his divine power has given us everything we need. That's past tense. So it's not up to you and me to say, God, I'm trying to get it from you. I'm trying to get what I need from you. No, it's already provided. Listen, always remember with God, it's your move then, yeah? Amen. It's your move to say, God, I hear what you're saying. I don't quite get it, but God, I'm in. I give you my heart. I give you my vote. I give you my allegiance, God. All right? It's up to you and me. It's provided we step into the place of receiving. I want to tell you this morning. It's not only provided, it happens by personal faith. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, it says, he who comes to God, anybody can come to God. That's the incredible message with Jesus. You don't have to be good enough to do it. Anybody can come to God. Anybody can come to God. How do you come to God? He who comes to God must believe that he is. Jesus, you are the Son of God. The Bible says that when you believe that, you instantly become born again. You're transformed from who you were into your new life. That's what the Bible says when you believe it. He who believes in the Son of God shall be saved. It's instant transformation on the inside. And we've talked a lot about that in our series that we did last called Who You Are. You become brand new on the inside when you believe. It's by personal faith in Jesus. Yes. That means it's up to you to exercise that faith, to say, you know what, God, I've been hearing about it, I've been thinking about it. You know, I haven't, you know, people in my family aren't doing this, people in my friends aren't necessarily doing this. I have no idea who's doing this at work, but God, I've been hearing about it enough that God, I wanna step towards you right now. Jesus, could you show me how this works? I believe in you. When you do that, you're coming to him with the thirst that's in your soul, and the Bible says that he satisfies it. He satisfies it. It's provided for. It happens by personal faith. Personal faith. Listen, I want to finish with this morning. It's present reality.
Amen.
It is right now. It's right where you are. Wherever you are. Whenever you're there. Driving around the city. Do you ever just turn off the radio, just kind of turn off the distractions or whatever, and just be like, Jesus, this is just time for me and you? He is right there, right where you are. You won't regret it. You set that little alarm clock of yours, you know, a half hour earlier, an hour earlier, and you get up there and you just sit on the couch, and you're just kind of like, okay, Jesus, before my day starts, I just want to connect with you. You will never regret that time. Mm-hmm. It's like going running early in the morning. Mm-hmm. It might be a bear to get going, right? But you'll never regret it once it's done. This is like time with Jesus. Only time with Jesus will fuel not just your natural body, but your spirit and your soul. Come on now, you'll never regret it. about to go into that meeting that could get a little tense or could get a little, you're not really sure what to expect, you just spend a moment with your hand on the doorknob, just kind of like, okay, Jesus, it's you and me. Everything that you need. Everything you need. Mm-hmm. The Bible says for that moment in your life, it's yours. Mm-hmm. Moment by moment, day by day, we can receive this invitation to come to him if we thirst. Mm-hmm. Any time of the day, any place. Mm-hmm. For some of you, this might be something that you're getting ready to do for the first time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just kind of like Jesus has been that thing that kind of comes up in the calendar every year, and there's a bunch of routine around that, and you know, the stores go crazy, and we all eat a lot of chocolate, and, you know, whatever, and I might go to, you know, there might be a bunch of kind of like cycles in your life around Jesus, or childhood ideas about him, or different things that you've heard, or, listen, you know, while I'm on it, don't, please don't judge Jesus by the way some Christians act. Okay? You know, Jesus stands apart from the church. We're the church trying to do our best to worship him and to show him off to the world, but over history, church has not done an incredible job at that at all times. When we get it right and we love each other and we move together in faith and it's all about Jesus, we are unstoppable as a church, isn't that right? But different believers, different churches in different parts of history, we get it wonky, we get it crooked, and it can become hurtful, and it can become something, I don't want anything to do with that. Don't judge the invitation of Jesus by what you see in church or what other Christians do. The invitation of Jesus still stands for you to say this. If there is a longing, if there's part of your soul that is unsatisfied, as blessed as your life might be, if you hunger for more, Jesus is saying, it's present, it's right now. Amen. He's saying, I'm right here. Mm-hmm. And just with a simple prayer, mm-hmm. with a simple opening of our heart by faith. So I'm going to end this message like I ended last week and talking about Revelation 3, verse 20. And it's those letters are in red. There's red letters in the back of your Bible as well as red, you know, during the stories of Jesus. Letters in red are the words that Jesus said. My Bible, those letters are all red. Revelation chapter 3. Verse 20, Jesus says this to the church. Mm-hmm. He says, behold, mm-hmm. I stand at the door of your heart, mm-hmm. the door of your church. Mm-hmm. And he says, I'm right here. Mm-hmm. It's not actually in the verse, but he's saying, I stand at the door and knock. Mm-hmm. You notice that? Mm-hmm. Well, he won't stop coming after you. He's right there. Mm-hmm. It's like this knocking in your, you know, it is right there, isn't it? I should open that thing. Oh, look, I'm so busy. You know, should open that. So here's where we ended last week. I'm going to end it here today and for the next couple of Sundays. Do this, and this is to the church, an invitation to the church. I'm at the door. If you will invite me in to your heart, to your life, to that thought process, to that problem, to that issue, if you'll invite me in, here's what Jesus says in that verse. He says, I will sit down. And we'll enjoy a great meal together. Yeah. We're going to sit down and we're going to talk about this, and I'm going to give you the keys and the solutions. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be right where you need me to be. I'm going to be right there with you. Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you, Jesus. So who's inviting him? Is he inviting you into something? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do we need to respond by an invitation to say, God, go ahead. Mm-hmm. I open the door. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Why don't we stand together this morning? Let's go ahead and pray. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Praise God. Praise God. You know, we've found that this can be sometimes the most powerful part of our service for you. You know, where we've sung about God and sung to God, and then we've talked about some of the things the Bible says. You know, this could be the moment where it just kind of all kind of comes home, right? This is the part of the service you get to take with you, what happens in the next few minutes. And so, judging by some clocks, we are way over time right now, so let's just to heck with it, and let's just kind of pray. Can we do that? Close your eyes with me if you can. Turn your heart towards the Lord. Father, in Jesus' name, we come before you. God, some of us, we're not too used to this. We don't even know necessarily what the protocol is or how to do it. God, I thank you that you invite us anyway. There might be things in our lives that we don't feel measure up. But God, you invite us anyway. So God, we bring you this morning the hunger of our soul. God, we bring you our thirst for something real, for something more. We bring before you, Father, our thirst. For you said, anyone who thirsts. You know, you can do this right in your seat, no problem. And Jesus can be really real to you. But I'm just going to take a step further this morning. And just like last week, if you feel like you want to respond to this invitation of Jesus, I feel his presence in this place. I want you to come on up to the front. Just kind of stand here. Just kind of just like this. And just say, Jesus, you're out again. I want to receive your invitation. I want to accept it. God, there's things that you've spoken and that you've said that have gripped my heart. And I don't quite get it, but Jesus, I want to say, here I am. Whether that's for the first time in a long time for you, first time ever, or whether for you that's just something that you just have to come back to again and again and again, I believe that the Spirit of God is here this morning to help you meet with Jesus and receive that invitation on a greater level. If that's you this morning, come on up to the front. Doesn't matter to me if that's one or two people or the whole works here. Let's accept the invitation of Jesus. Can we do that this morning? Just while we're praying, let's turn that music up a little bit. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. Come on, let's just spend a few minutes before the Lord. If you'd like to say to Jesus, I accept your invitation, come stand up front. Just stand up here. Just stand up before God. And we'll pray with you and believe God.